ICS5. This is part two of the social regulation in Bitcoin lecture. So in part one, we talked about what Bitcoin is, why people use it, and how it might impact the environment. In part two, I want to talk about how Bitcoin is regulated and things that we can think about for the future to maybe make Bitcoin better. Okay, so if you haven't watched part one, I recommend going back and watching it. But just to refresh you, we have this decentralized currency, Bitcoin, that is not under the control of a government, bank, or any centralized organization. It's actually under the control of the network of users who run the software that verifies transactions. And as we discussed, it may be better for the environment than conventional currencies. So this sounds really great, right? But there's some problems. What stops people from stealing bitcoins or ripping each other off? One thing that actually did not get discussed in the previous video, but is very relevant, is that Bitcoin transactions are irreversible. If I give you a Bitcoin for a PS4, for example, and you never send me the PS4, well, what do I do? If you're a nice person, maybe you'll say, well, okay, I actually am all out of stock of PS4, so here's your Bitcoin back. But I can't force you to do that. There's no payment intermediary who can return that money to me. Now, there are people who are working on this issue, but right now that is the case. So how are norms developed among the users so they know who they can do transactions with? So is it that they trust Bitcoin? And if so, what about Bitcoin do they trust? So some people argue that Bitcoin users trust the network and the code and not individual people. In fact, Andreas Antonopoulos, who is a central figure in the Bitcoin community, says that there's no central authority or trusted third party in its distributed consensus network. So he's saying we don't need to trust any one person. We just need to trust the network of users. As I discussed in the first part of this lecture, the network will determine which transactions are valid, and if there's any disputes, essentially what happens is the network of computers votes on which are the correct chain of transactions that have been made. So as long as you can trust the network, you should be able to trust Bitcoin. So that's great, and I think that is true. However, this still doesn't really solve this issue of what happens when people steal or run scams. And this is something that I don't actually see brought up very often when people talk about trust in Bitcoin. And in fact, another issue as well is that the code sometimes breaks, and then you have issues where the transactions that have been made may be not compatible with other versions of the code, or there may be incorrect transactions that have been recorded. So what do we do? So first of all, I want to talk a little bit about why this is even important that we're even asking this question. So one thing is that Bitcoin is a decentralized system, and decentralized systems, I think, will be crucial in the event of a large-scale disaster or collapse. So like the internet, which is a distributed system, arguably, for communication, and it really revolutionized the way that we communicate, Bitcoin is a distributed system for finance. And if a government collapses, then that currency of that government may be completely worthless. But with Bitcoin, since it's a global currency and it's not related to any government, it may help prevent those sorts of financial losses for people who live in unstable countries. Secondly, decentralized systems can be really empowering. A lot of the people that I've spoken to when I've researched Bitcoin feel that governments and banks don't always act in their best interests. And so they appreciate that with Bitcoin, they don't have to worry about some other person making a decision for them about what should happen with their money. They're in complete control. So it's really important that we understand how these sorts of systems are regulated, because I really do think that if not Bitcoin, some sort of decentralized financial system is here to stay. And so it's really important to know how we can make these systems easy to use and safe for people to use. So there are three types of regulation of Bitcoin that I want to talk about. There's social regulation, code regulation, and government regulation. So in terms of social regulation, there's the regulation of individuals and organizations. I spoke to a number of Bitcoin users about how they know to trust other users. And they said that they look at the reputation of the user, and there are websites that will track reputation, where people can leave reviews for other users, essentially. They look at the openness of the people that they're doing transactions with, the transparency, how helpful they are. So they look at maybe the forum posts that the user has made, or any number of things. And they see if that person seems trustworthy. So an example of this is one of my participants in my study of Bitcoin told me about how there was a website that was sort of like Kiva, which is a microfinance website, where you give small loans out to people and they pay you back over time. And usually it's for things like, education, starting a business, since you're making small loans, usually the risk is kind of low if you don't get paid back. But generally, in these traditional microfinance websites, the rate of repayment is very, very high. But with Bitcoin, since it's harder for people to really be accountable for their actions, since it is pseudo-anonymous, the rate of repayment is a lot lower. So even when he researched people and tried to determine who was the right person to give money to, he found that he didn't always get his money back. So it's very difficult to figure out who you can trust always. So organizations. So there are a lot of third-party organizations that offer Bitcoin services. So one was Mt. Gox, which stands for Magic the Gathering Online Exchange. It was originally, the URL was going to be exactly that. It was going to be for exchanging Magic the Gathering cards. But eventually, they decided to do something different with that URL, and they decided to make it a Bitcoin exchange instead. And it became wildly popular. So it started in 2010, and by 2013, 70% of Bitcoin transactions were going through Mt. Gox. And so if you wanted to buy Bitcoins using the US dollar, that's generally where you would go. If you wanted to know the current exchange rate for Bitcoin, that is generally where you would go. However, in 2014, Mt. Gox all of a sudden shut down. And they said that there was a huge amount of Bitcoins that were missing. And nobody knows if they were stolen, if it was mismanaged. It's very unclear what happened. As a result, there's this picture here on the side of someone who actually flew to their headquarters in Japan to protest and to ask where the money went. There wasn't a great deal of transparency. And when I spoke to participants in my study about this, they all said, yes, they weren't very good about being transparent. So they knew something was up, and they didn't necessarily trust Mt. Gox, but there was a huge amount of people who did. And so this is a big issue with Bitcoin, is it's very hard to know who you can trust, and can be very time-consuming to try and figure this out. Another type of regulation that I want to talk about is code regulation. So Bitcoin is open source software, and what that means is that the code for Bitcoin is all online. I could download it and play around with it myself and make changes to it if I wanted. In fact, I could make a spin-off project if I wanted to as well. So one of the benefits to open source software is that anyone can look at the code, so if there are any bugs, it may be easier to spot than if you have, a few engineers who are working on this product and no one else but the engineers can really verify that there are bugs, or can at least find where there's a bug in the code. So open source software can be really great for that reason. But one thing about open source software is it's not that anyone ever can contribute to it. There are certain procedures in place, usually, that restrict who can submit changes to the code. And there's very much a hierarchy with open source software, which is not something that always gets discussed when we talk about open source software. So there is regulation within the structure of open source software and within the regulation of Bitcoin. There are a few main developers, and major changes to the code need to go through them. So that's one type of regulation that we see. So government regulation is another important form of regulation that affects Bitcoin. When Bitcoin was originally started, people weren't even sure if it was legal or not. Now the current issue with governments is more trying to decide whether Bitcoin should be viewed as a currency or a commodity, and whether it should be taxed, and if so, how it should be taxed. So the Bitcoin community founded the Bitcoin Foundation to deal with this and to advise governments how Bitcoin works, what are the best ways to regulate it in the best interest of the Bitcoin community. And I want to clarify that the Bitcoin Foundation is not a centralized authority. They don't manage Bitcoin. All the people who are on the board are elected, and they're really just there to advise. Now, there are some debates within the Bitcoin community about the role of the Bitcoin Foundation. Some people really like them. Some people see them as a necessary evil. Some people don't like that they're so focused on American politics. There are branches of the Bitcoin Foundation that are focused on other countries. I believe there's a Bitcoin Foundation Australia, for example. And so this is one way in which the Bitcoin community has been dealing with government regulation. So to summarize, I think decentralization is great. I think that it will be the future of finances. Whether or not it's Bitcoin or some other decentralized system is yet to be seen. I think it can be better for the environment, but without knowing how to trust individuals and organizations, decentralization is really difficult. It requires a lot of work for people to actually use it. So where do we go from here? I think there are a couple of different solutions. One might be reputation tracking. So we already do have some systems in place for reputation tracking, but maybe there's a more formal way that that could be built into the code. Maybe there's a way to partially centralize Bitcoin or some other similar currency that would definitely go against some of the ideals of Bitcoin, but it may make it more practical. So there's a lot of different things that could be done to maybe make it a little bit easier to use. And perhaps those won't be done to Bitcoin. It might be a spin-off currency. It remains to be seen. But I hope that you'll think about these things throughout the quarter. And perhaps it'll be something that you work on for your class project or a project in the future. I would love it if people in this class helped figure out some of these really fundamental issues with using Bitcoin. Anyway, thank you for listening to the lecture. If you have any questions or comments, you can email me at clustig@uci.edu. Thanks.